Pro Group Management. Workers' comp that works for you.
Welcome to Nevada Newsmakers. On the broadcast today, we're talking education with Assemblywoman Jill Tolles for the whole show on the all-new Nevada Newsmakers.
Safety. We all think about it. You think about it when he buckles in, when you check your mirrors and put away your phone. RTC thinks about safety too. In fact, we create it. Center turn lanes mean fewer blind spots. Bike lanes keep cyclists and you safe. Roundabouts reduce injury collisions, and all these crosswalks are designed to keep families like yours safe. Safety is your priority, and it's ours too. Every day, in everything we do.
Retail's impact on Nevada's economy? Enormous. 8,600 businesses, large and small, employing 145,000 workers. And last fiscal year, retail paid tax on nearly $60 billion in sales. We're the Retail Association of Nevada. We support retail. We help it grow. And we mean business.
RANNV.org.
Pro Group Management is the place where companies can find workers' comp solutions that are designed to meet their specific business requirements. As regulations evolve, Pro Group takes a proactive approach to clear the path to make sure your business stays ahead of the curve. Knowing your workers' comp program is optimized, you can focus on other important matters related to your growing business. Pro Group Management, workers' comp that works for you.
This is Nevada Newsmakers with host Sam Shan, a no-holds-barred political forum. Now, from the Nevada Newsmakers broadcast headquarters, here is Sam Shan.
I am back on Nevada Newsmakers. We're always delighted to welcome back to the program Assemblywoman Jill Tolles of District 25. Pleasure to have you back on the program.
Always good to see you, Sam. Thanks so much for having me.
Thank you. So, obviously, the governor announced the major budget cuts last week. We're taping this, by the way, on the morning of June 15th, so people have a time frame reference. Your big thing has always been from day one education, so yeah. Your thoughts at the beginning of this?
Well, as you know, the first time I came on this show was almost 10 years ago, and at that time I was a citizen, a mom, an educator in higher ed myself, and I was engaging in politics at the very beginning out of a passion for supporting education reform and funding. And at that time, I remember sitting in a room with 20 other leaders and addressing then Governor Sandoval over $123 million of cuts to education over a five-year period of time. And what we saw last Friday in the Interim Finance Committee was a presentation on the $812 million revenue shortfall that we were experiencing just in fiscal year 2020 alone, and how that translated to $265 million in cuts to K through 12 education in one day. So for someone like me who's been engaged in this discussion for a decade or so, and I know there's many others been engaged for much, much longer than that, it was just, it's heart-wrenching to look at the numbers that we're facing. And that was just for fiscal year 2020. Now we're looking at fiscal year 2021, which starts in 2 weeks, July 1st, and we're anticipating a $1.3 billion shortfall out of a $4.5 billion budget for that year.
So almost 25% of the budget.
Right.
Which is just stunning.
Yeah. So now we won't feel those $265 million of cuts by and large because A, we're getting to the end of the school year, and B, an earlier IFC committee did vote to sweep the rainy day fund, and much of that is going to be used to cover that shortfall. But it's inevitable to take a look at this next fiscal year and ask, how are we going to cover this shortfall?
All right, so your thoughts on that?
Yeah, well, I think first we need to start by taking a look at what's been done already. And I do have some concerns about some of the things that we've done in this past 3-month period. For example, the Rainy Day Fund, You know, if we look back historically at how our bond ratings are evaluated as a state, which gives us the ability to borrow money at a more reasonable rate, well, Pew Research published an article back in May of 2017 taking a look at how different states fared in the last recession. And they used Nevada as an example of how not to do it, in the sense that we raided the rainy day fund before we made cuts, and as a result, that hurt our bond rating. And so in this last, you know, 3-month period of time, we asked for agencies to give us projections for cuts, but we didn't actually implement them. And so when we swept the entire rainy day fund in that earlier IFC meeting without coupling that with cuts, inevitably that is going to hurt our ability to raise and borrow money at a more reasonable rate and to really stretch those taxpayer dollars out. And also in addition, there's some things that we could have done earlier, knowing that this fiscal crisis was upon us, that there's nothing that's going to be easy about this, but I'm of the belief that sooner is better than later. And had we done some of those measures earlier, it would have at least spread out the impact a little bit further. So for example, we know that if we furlough state employees, which nobody wants to do, we appreciate our state employees. We know many of them are frontline, you know, first responders. There's nothing easy about that conversation, but as you noted, Governor Sisolak finally announced last week that is going to be the plan for next fiscal year. Well, we can save $16 million potentially a day for every day that we furlough. So had we implemented that over this period where many employees were working from home during this COVID crisis, just even once a month, that would have equated to, you know, roughly $45 million to $48 million. If it was twice a month, it would have been twice that. And it's not enough to cover the spread, but it's something that could contribute to help to spread it out a little bit further. I don't know about you, but when I was at camp, when I was a little kid, we did this little exercise where everyone had to get in a circle and they had to all sit down together, but they had to all figure out how to stand back up together. And the only way to do that was for everybody to link arms, to lean in, and to gradually, slowly raise back up together. And that's the situation that we're in right now. If we all can lean in and we can all share into the sacrifice, we've certainly asked our businesses to sacrifice. They had a 24-hour notice to be furloughed. They had a 24-hour notice to be furloughed for 2 to 3 months. So there's a lot of people making sacrifices right now. If we can all share in that sacrifice, lean in together, it's not going to be easy, but I do believe we can get through it.
Were you disappointed by the response from AFSCME's representative last week on hearing about the potential furloughs to immediately say, well, you know, we're always the first ones to be asked to give up? It seemed like that wasn't the appropriate thing to respond.
Yeah.
Especially when you've seen what's happened to the general public and businesses.
Yeah, I always understand people are going to advocate for their own, and I think what makes this coronavirus crisis that is both economic in nature primarily at this point, as well as still a health crisis. Just ask the 23 people who passed away in my district in one nursing home. It is still very real. It's a time for everybody who is an advocate for their various groups to come together and look at that child who is at home, who is has an independent education plan, who has had no resources for occupational therapy, for people in our mental health system who are not receiving the mental health and substance use disorder treatments that they need, or to people who need support for dialysis or they're going to die. Every single one of us has to recognize that we are all at this table, and that's again how we're going to need to come forward. To the small businesses, as you know, my husband's company, we have 120 tenants in downtown and midtown Reno, commercial real estate company. 40 of those are in retail, restaurant, and bars. It has been heartbreaking to see them completely flatlined for 2, and in some cases still 3 months. Some of these businesses and restaurants close their doors, will never reopen again. And so we have to have, it's a time where we need to have some empathy. We need to put ourselves in each other's shoes. We need to all be able to come in together to get through this.
Okay, so in talking about coming together, it seems like at the IFC meeting, you know, things were being done in a party line split. Has the governor and you had conversations? Has the governor reached out to you in any way?
So I hate party line votes just because of how they look. And I will say that all my votes, and I was on served on that committee that day, all my votes are because I genuinely believe what I believe in that moment. I don't always get it right, but but you can always know that the reasons for my votes are because I have issues with something, and if I do, I just can't get there to yes right that day. If I can, and if we do, to your point, have the ability to collaborate, to talk through those things ahead of time, which is what I'm always in favor of, then hopefully we can get to better outcomes and to better votes and better decisions. The governor did reach out to me probably, I would say, about 6 weeks ago or so, and he reached out to a number of legislators and just to touch base, and I appreciated that. We have not spoken since then, and I do know that it's really important that, especially when it comes to a crisis this big, with the legislative leadership in both houses, on both sides of the aisle, and also with the executive branch, that I'm a believer that the more of us that are there at the table who can help get us through this crisis, the better off we are for all of Nevadans. And I will give credit to Speaker Frierson, who did call together. We had talked about the importance of calling all leadership together, so we've had one phone call with leadership from both houses and both sides of the aisle, and I'm hopeful that we will continue to do that as we move towards bigger discussions and continue to work with, my hope would be to continue to work with the executive branch, because that's what's needed right now for the constituents we serve.
One of the big problems I see, we had the state superintendent of schools on the program, and she was talking about social distancing on buses, social distancing in the classroom. And my concern there is that, you know, we never have enough teachers, we never have enough bus drivers, buses, et cetera. Mm-hmm. They're talking about maybe 2 days a week in school, 2 days a week at home.
Yeah.
It just seems like this is a huge problem we're just about to hit.
Yeah.
Not that staying at home for 3 months wasn't a big problem.
Right. And we're not the only ones facing this. It is across the United States, as our universities and our community colleges are wrestling through this, as our K-12 education system is wrestling through this. Certainly clear that in the early results of surveys of parents, they are in favor of getting their kids back in school for a variety of reasons.
Yes. So
that was a resounding response. But we do still have to balance out health risks to vulnerable populations. So I don't see how we cannot, at least on an ongoing basis in the near-term future, always have some form of distance learning available for perhaps students with underlying conditions, or if they have family members that they live with who have underlying conditions, or, and let's not leave out our teachers and our administrative staff who may be vulnerable. So there's always going to have to be some level, and we're having these conversations at the university level. As you know, I teach at the University of Nevada, Reno. I had to switch my classes to online mid-semester. That was the first time in 16 years I've ever taught a class online. But you have some professors that are in that vulnerable category. So I don't see how we move forward without always having a piece of extended distance learning available, which I don't know is a bad thing. We've talked a lot about the importance of innovation in times of crisis, and I think that there's some needed innovation here that we need to continue to build off of that infrastructure. But there are going to be students that, as safely as we can, and teachers as safely as we can, we'd really like to get them back on campus for social emotional learning issues, for academic outcome issues, for access to the online learning, and the inability for some families to be able to make that work. Distance learning has not worked for them. So I'd like to see us be able to, as much as we safely can, get them back into schools. One other hidden thing that most people don't think about, as you know, I'm also very passionate about child abuse prevention. And I pulled the data from our county. How many reports have we had in child abuse in the last 3 months as compared to 3 months a year ago? And the reporting is down. Now, I don't believe for one nanosecond that the abuse is down. In fact, if you talk to our pediatric nurses and doctors, they're seeing horrendous cases of child abuse
and
neglect.
Right, and the DA was on the program talking about that as well.
Exactly. But the reason the reporting is down is because our schools are often our first responders.
Right.
They're our first mandatory reporters.
So the kids are not having an opportunity to be able to make that complaint.
So as much as we can have them see each other face to face, it's good as long as we can keep it safe.
Okay, let's take a break. More with Jill Tolles after this timeout.
Because of UMC, I'm putting my free time to good use.
Because of UMC, she keeps me on my toes.
Because of UMC and this guy, I'm here.
UMC, the highest level of care in Nevada.
Hi, I'm Eric Robnett, owner of Home Energy Experts. Has this ever happened to you?
Honey, did you remember to turn down the thermostat?
Forgetting to set the temperature? Not fun. We can help. Our new smart thermostat keeps the temperature set for your comfort all by itself.
I'm feeling hot now.
To increase your comfort, go to homeenergyexperts.com for details. That's homeenergyexperts.com.
The signs and symptoms of cataracts can start out small with subtle changes in your vision. So don't wait. Be proactive and take your vision into your own hands. If you're experiencing the onset of cataracts or just have questions, contact your eye care professional or call Eye Care Associates of Nevada today. Dr. Hiss has years of experience specializing in the surgical correction of eye disorders and has completed over 84,000 vision-correcting procedures. At Eye Care Associates of Nevada, we'll change the way you look at the world.
Dad? Why are you learning? This place is great.
Huh?
You gotta try this. Wow! This stuff is great! People are gonna love it!
Yes. Yes, they were.
This is Nevada Newsmakers.
And back on Nevada Newsmakers, we continue our conversation with Assemblywoman Jill Tolles. So a couple of things that you brought up here, let's at least address them briefly. One of the concerns that a lot of people have, especially educators, but parents as well, is with the kids being kept out of school, that there is a need for social interaction. That is part of the learning process. Right. Does that concern you that that has been missing here for the last 3 months?
Absolutely, and we've replaced it with more screen time, which we know from all sorts of neurological research and publications from everyone from the Pediatrics Association to even actually our ocular health. Staring at a screen too long, we're seeing higher rates of dry eye among children because their eyes are open and they're staring too long, and that can create, even in some cases, permanent damage. So I definitely think that interaction piece is so important. You know, I have two daughters and they're now home. One of them was away at college and came home over spring break permanently, and the other is a junior in high school at Washoe County School District. And last night we had for the first time some friends over, and they had younger kids. My daughters were so excited to spend time even with kids who were 5-6 years younger than them, just because it was social interaction.
Right.
And so yes, that social emotional learning piece, I know we've talked about this in past, I know you've talked about this in past shows, the ability for kids to be able to talk to one another, look each other in the eye, all those nonverbal parts of communication that we lose out on when we're only on this all day long. And so I think that it's going to be really important that we continue to build around bringing our kids back into that social interaction.
And society was not made for husbands and wives and children to be locked up together for extended periods of time. We will move on from that, but that's just my comment. Another issue that the state superintendent brought up was broadband access.
Yes.
In the big cities and in the middle class and wealthier neighborhoods, there's great access to the internet. But you go out into rural Nevada, you go out into poor areas of Nevada, and they don't have very good internet access. And the federal government has been trying to boost this for years now. Mm-hmm. But is that on your list of concerns?
Yes, absolutely. And I've reached out to Charter and AT&T, and I know that in the past Switch has been engaged and other private companies have been engaged with really trying to help bolster our internet access and our infrastructure across the state. And so at a time when we're facing the budget cuts that we are inevitably facing, it's going to be really hard to find more dollars to invest. But I do think that that public-private partnership and possibly looking at ways to be able to utilize some of this federal funding that was actually part of the CARES Act package was to help with that distance learning and the telecommuting from home piece for our state employees who were not able to come into the office. And so I think that it's needs to all be part of that discussion.
All right, let's take another break and we'll be right back.
Dimitri Prine here for Design Outdoor. Come visit Design Outdoor's store and backyard to see our wide selection of fire pits, barbecues, and pizza ovens, natural stone water features and fountains, and frostproof pottery. Our store and backyard are located at 11600 South Virginia, just north of DeMonte Ranch Parkway. Visit designoutdoor.com or call us at 851-9499.
One of the most psychologically damaging things parents can do to children in divorce is disparage one another, which is why I can't believe I even have to make this commercial. Half of your kids' genetics come from this person you're spewing hate about. Your children have the right to love you both, but more than that, they deserve to love themselves.
Marilyn York might be a men's rights divorce attorney, but this is for every selfish parent. Shut up!
Hi, I'm Dave Newman. Remember me? I used to be the house detective, and now I'm a realtor, full-time at RE/MAX Realty Affiliates. And a lot of people ask me, how's the market? You know what? It's fantastic. If you're even kicking around the idea of buying or selling, give me a call. Let's talk about it. Call me at RE/MAX Realty Affiliates and just ask for the guy who used to be the house detective, Dave Newman.
Everyone is talking about opioids, but they're not the only drugs that can be harmful if taken in large quantities or not as prescribed. You also need to be aware of side effects from anxiety drugs, muscle relaxants, sleep aids, and stimulants. Mixing prescription drugs with other drugs or alcohol can be dangerous. If you take Ambien with a glass of wine, it may be enough to stop you from breathing. Prescribed drugs can be just as dangerous as illegal drugs. Take medications only as directed.
This is Nevada Newsmakers.
And back on Nevada Newsmakers, we continue our conversation with Assemblywoman Jill Tolles of District 25. So the states obviously are going to need help from another version of the CARES Act. The concern in Congress on the Republican side in the Senate is that the states are asking for help with things that are not connected to COVID, that they're connected to pension funds that are not sufficiently funded. And that's causing a problem here. Yeah. What is your confidence level from the people you're talking to that there can be some accommodation here? Because otherwise it's not just going to be Nevada, it's going to be a lot of states that are going to have serious, serious problems.
Right. Well, I think it is important that we really look at what the Treasury outlined on what the CARES Act funding was meant for. And if you can access it, it's easily readily accessible online. There was an April 22nd memo from the Treasury Department on outlining ways that we can utilize the CARES Act funding. And obviously the first priority was in the response to flatten the curve. And as has been mentioned in the show and by many others before, that was to really give our hospitals the ability to build up the infrastructure for a response. And we've successfully done that. But then as a result of that, we now have this economic crisis where you do have businesses across the state that have shuttered their doors for 2 months, in some cases 3 months, and they the subsequent revenue shortfalls that impacts our state budget. So how do we help those businesses come back online? And so something that I've spent a lot of time on is working with small businesses in our community to hear what their needs are, what are the challenges they're facing, reopening their doors. It's not just flipping the light switch back on. And how can we utilize programs that other states across the United States have utilized CARES Act funding to help bridge that recovery for those small businesses? And so many of the programs that we see, Utah, I constantly go to as having excellent examples. We've seen this now, thankfully, here in Nevada, in Las Vegas, who just recently rolled out with their CARES Act funding. They were allocated pretty early on. There's grants, small grants for businesses, small loans for businesses. There's rent relief to help with the supply chain of being able to pay your rent, which helps the landlord, which helps the banks, which helps the insurers beyond. And then also for people that are just gonna find themselves not coming back to work because that job has been eliminated, how do we retrain and upskill them into new positions?
Okay, so just one quick question here, quick answer. So do you think that there's gonna be another round of funding that will help states out?
I don't know for sure, but I know that there's a lot of people banking on that. I do have some concerns about printing money left and right, but we'll just have to see how that pans out.
And that's where we have to leave it. Jill Toll, it's always a pleasure. Thank you for being here.
Yeah.
And we'll be right back.
A bird's eye captures its surroundings at different heights. At Brian Culpa Photography, we can make your imagination soar over buildings, parks, cityscapes, and beyond. Brian's images tell the story and get the job done. If you need a new perspective to tell your story, contact Brian today. Brian Culpa Photography. Experience the bird's eye view at brianculpaphotography.com.
Penny! Dad? What are you learning? This place is great.
Huh?
You gotta try this. Wow! This stuff is great! People are gonna love it!
Yes. Yes, they were.
As you know, Reno is booming. Toll's development company is helping it grow with insightful design and development, building community with every project, adding beauty, adding excitement, emphasizing our shared humanity. Reno is becoming bigger. Toll's development is helping it become better, more livable, more enjoyable. To learn more, go to tollsdevelopment.com. tollsdevelopment.com.
Pro Group Management specializes in providing industries with the necessary components to satisfy and exceed workers' comp requirements. Every business has unique needs and specific regulations. Pro Group Management stays ahead of the curve, providing up-to-date services to keep your industry in top form. Discover how we simplify your tasks, improve efficiency, and reduce expense to keep you moving in a positive direction. Pro Group Management, workers' comp that works for you.
You can now watch Nevada Newsmakers on YouTube. Just go to YouTube and search for Nevada Newsmakers and become a subscriber. We'll see you on the next broadcast. Thanks for watching and listening.